is paid for and furnished by its producer, host, and sponsors. And with that, we say it is time for the East Ramapo Underground.
Up in the morning and out to school.
Good morning to the East Ramapo Underground on WRCR 1700. This is your co-host, Antonio Luciano, with
Peggy Hatton. Welcome, everybody.
Yes, welcome to this frigid February morning in Rockland County.
Yeah, I don't miss that. It's 64 degrees and sunny right now, so I don't miss the New York winters, that's for sure.
Oh, Peggy.
You'll have to come down and visit me.
I'll be on the next plane.
Okay,
leaving from Stewart Airport probably at noon. If things keep going the way they are.
I'll pick you up at Jacksonville. No problem, Tony.
Okay, but we should really jump into the show. So first we have our heroes.
I need a hero. I'm holding out for a hero till the end of the night. He's gotta be strong and he's gotta be fast and he's gotta be fresh from the fight. I need a hero.
And we do have heroes in East Ramapo. We're very happy to say. The first Hero Award goes to Commissioner Mary Ellen Elia, and I'm probably mispronouncing her name, so forgive me, for coming to visit the beleaguered East Ramapo School District earlier this week. That means that she visited twice since her appointments in August. She continues to show compassion for our students, and we hope that that will turn into real solutions to provide a quality education for everyone in East Ramapo. It should be noted that all of the previous commissioners would not come anywhere near East Ramapo and did everything that they could do to ignore our plight. Bravo to Commissioner. We really appreciate your attention. And the second Hero Award goes to a newcomer to the East Ramapo Underground Hero Group, and that is none other than Julie Globus. She gets the second Hero Award for responding to Aaron Weider's diatribe at the last county legislative meeting. Julie, who is Jewish herself, authored a letter, quote, anti-Semitism, a label too often used to shield the fight and to fight off scrutiny, end quote, as was published in the Rockland Voice and Clarkstown What They Don't Want You to Know Facebook pages. Julie calls out Weider, Hykind, Gestetner, and Polachek for their deplorable behavior. Julie answers each and every one of their bogus claims eloquently. This Hero Award is for you, Julie. Thank you for all you did.
And Peggy, our next Hero Award is a repeat hero. He's county,
deservedly so.
He's County Executive Ed Day. Ed has been a target of Aaron Weider ever since Ed took office. And Ed has not shied away, but rather he has taken on the bogus arguments Weider has put forth and vigorously defended Rockland County residents against unfounded charges of anti-Semitism. Day said, and I quote, I have identified Mr. Weider and his cohort's playbook, create an illusion of hate here in Rockland as to elevate the East Ramapo monitor issue to a statewide concern in attempt to stop the oversight bill from passing. We are all better than him, and this frustrates him. End quote. End quote. Bravo, Ed. We agree with you. This Hero Award is for you. And now for you out there who are waiting on pins and needles, this is our Zero segment.
I'm a loser. I'm a loser.
And the first Zero is no stranger to this segment. It is none other than Aaron Weider, the architect of East Ramapo School District destruction. He gets the first Zero. During the time that he was president of the school board, I just lost my place, that he was president of the school board, he knew that the roofs in many schools needed to be replaced. And the board had $17 million in reserves that could have fixed these roofs. But instead of fulfilling his fiduciary responsibility, Weider emptied the reserves by artificially lowering the tax rate. Reserves are meant to be a rainy day fund.
And I wonder, still I wonder, who'll stop the rain?
The architect spent weeks in Albany spreading lies about the bill being anti-Semitic last year. He is using the same tactic this year by trying to paint all of Rockland as being anti-Semitic. Please, let's not provide any ammunition for his counterfeit war against the children of East Ramapo. Weider, this zero award is for you. And the next zero should not be any surprise either. The next zero goes to interloper Assemblyman Dove Hikind.
Lovey-dovey, lovey-dovey, lovey-dovey all the time.
Hikind is from Brooklyn, and lovey-dovey took another ill-conceived field trip to Rockland County to call upon Attorney General Schneiderman to investigate Rockland County, which he said was, quote, a cesspool of hate, end quote. The architect, Weider, stood by Hikind's side. After much pushback from local elected officials and many Jewish individuals, Jewish groups, etc., Benny and the Jets via OJPAC retreated from Dovey's broad-brushing the entire county as being a cesspool of hate. And instead, they said, quote, Hikind spoke about hateful actions of specific people, not the county as a whole, end quote. Gee, nice try to save face, not even blackface. But after the debacle, lovey-dovey, this zero award goes to you and is well-deserved. And can I just add here also, Tony, that overnight there was a video of Dove Hikind. He can't just let it go, attacking legislator Lori Santulli, and taking, again, words that she said out of context and attacking her via video and putting it out there on, I know you hate this, Steve, but his Facebook page. It's really atrocious that he continues with taking people's words out of context and using them against the person. But she is a public official, and she is a grown woman, so she will have her own response. But just add that little tidbit to the zero, because he really just keeps it coming and coming.
Yeah,
on to you, Tony.
Yeah, and Peggy, it's really something when you say Rockland County is a cesspool of hate,
mm-hmm.
and then say, I only meant some people.
Right. Well, and of course, you know, others have called in last week and have accused us of that. So, you know, it's become, you know, the words of anti-Semitism and the charges of anti-Semitism, unfortunately, is growing very weak because it's overused and it's not true for many of the times that people say it is. Are there posts out there that are anti-Semitic? Of course there are. Are there people out there who are racist from the other side? Of course there are. There are bad and good in every ethnic group. So I think that just needs to be dropped.
Well, Peggy, I want to address something that happened last Friday on the morning show. You know, some lame brain called up and said we're on Ed Day's payroll.
Uh-huh.
You know, so
I remember.
Actually, I have to split the money with you.
Oh, good. How much am I getting, Tony?
Well, Peggy, half of nothing is nothing. So, no, don't spend it all in one place.
I was not counting on it.
Yeah. You know, the check will be in the mail.
Okay. Waiting for it.
And let's open up the studio lines. Oh, wait. First, you know, I heard this, that there's a new theme song for Ramapo High School.
Uh-huh.
And here it comes.
Raindrops are falling on my head and they keep falling.
They're singing it every day now before assembly.
Yes, and choir. I forgot. We don't have choir anymore, do we?
No, we don't. So let's open up the studio lines at 845-362-0013. Our lines are open, people. Don't wait till the last 10 minutes to call. We know you're out there. You can call Friday on the morning show. You can call this show, too. Don't be afraid.
Very good.
You know, someone on the morning show this morning, I was listening here in the studio, and they talked about that we complain about everything. And it's not actually true.
Right.
We complain about abuses in the system. So when they mentioned about the boardroom. I put pictures up of the new boardroom and the new chairs and said, we just complain. Well, here's a school board that builds a brand new boardroom with a new dais for them and new microphones. And there were chairs that were in the order, you know, the gym before.
Right.
They were functional. So they right. actually went out and bought, I counted them, 244 brand new chairs.
Right.
Now, you can't keep claiming you're a cash-strapped district and you have limited funds and then go frivolously spending money on chairs and a podium so you look, you know, a day so you look nice.
Here's the other thing about that, too, Tony.
But before we get into that, we do have a caller, so I don't want to hold them up.
Okay.
So, good morning to the East Ramapo Underground on WRCR 1700.
Hello, this is Peter from Pomona. How are you two today?
Hi, Peter.
Yeah, thanks,
I'm freezing.
Yeah,
well, I'm good.
Cold. It's sunny but cold. But anyway, this whole mess with East Ramapo has been upsetting me for quite a while. And Aaron Weeder, I know he, you know, I'm sure that he's a good husband and a good father to his kids. And I know he calls up the morning show, and you know he's very nice on the show. But
not to Ed.
No, not to Ed. And his behavior is just despicable. He goes around throwing around a serious term of anti-Semitism, trying to say that it's anti-Semitic to have a monitor with veto power in the school board. And I mean, it's just shameful the way he's acting and the way he conducts himself regarding the East Ramapo school district. And as you said, if he was a member of the board, he knows all the problems that the school board face and the school's face, and
right.
he's just doing this obviously to keep himself popular with people who voted for him. But he really should be ashamed of the way that he is behaving, and the things that he's saying. And I'm sure he won't ever call up this show to talk because he would be challenged.
No, he has called up a couple of times. You know.
Yes.
Yeah, I give him credit for that.
All right. You know. Good, at least.
Well, it's been a very long time. We should also point out, Tony.
It's few
and
far between.
And I think your point is well taken that he would be challenged. And I think that's why Mr. Gesettner said earlier this morning that he wouldn't be calling into our show. Because they know they can't put falsehoods out there without us answering them. So I agree with you.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, you know, the East Ramapo High School that roof has had problems for years now. Nothing was done. And you said there was a big surplus of money that they should have used to fix the roofs and fix the schools, and now they say, oh, we want more money. Why didn't the bond pass at $42 million? And people have called up and said, you know, there's $50 million that they're being shorted to from the state, and they should have that. But they certainly shouldn't get a penny of more money unless there's someone overseeing how those funds are distributed.
We agree.
And Peter, you know, people fail to realize there were reports of the buildings needed $33.5 million of repairs back in 2010. The district reported that to NYSED. Then it comes around, you have $17 million in reserves that can go towards fixing the building. And people don't realize part of that money would be refunded back to the district. So it's not like you're spending all $17
million
and getting nothing back.
Right.
You would get anywhere from like 55 to 60%. It might even be more for East Ramapo.
I think it is more, Tony.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So you're getting back like $8 to $9 million of what you spend. But, you know, you don't put it towards repairs because where are your priorities? It's not towards the children or the school building themselves.
Yeah, I mean, they seem to, you know, there's 24,000 children go to the yeshivas, and they, you know, that requires funding, of course, but you can't leave the 8,000 kids who are out in the public schools out in the cold with terrible conditions at East Ramapo High School and Ramapo High School. I think Spring Valley High School has a lot of problems.
Yes, and Chestnut Ridge, too, and Pomona. They all have leaking roofs.
Yeah, I mean, that's just shameful. It's just, I don't know what the solution is. The solution is for the state to come over and take over completely and disband the East Ramapo School Board, or just have a monitor in there to make sure the funds go where they should. But it seems like it's a very frustrating situation, and the progress is extremely painfully slow.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and every year that goes by, of course, the kids are being cheated out of a decent education and not receiving even mandated services. So, we appreciate our local electives up there, Ellen Jaffe, Ken Zabrowski, Carlucci was said to have gotten $1 million. But, it's taking far too long because the kids don't get these years back. So we agree with you.
Well, here's the other thing. You talk about the $1 million Carlucci got. Walcott claimed in September that they found $1 million in the budget to go to capital improvements.
Right.
But what happened to that money?
Because, yeah, right.
And then Klein, just before
and can I just say, if you don't know what happened to the money, Tony, then no one outside of the board and the administration knows, because it was never discussed publicly, correct?
Right, and I don't think it was actually set aside. They found the $1 million that could be used, but it wasn't dedicated to capital improvements.
Right.
Klein said in October that the state had told him that they were going to give East Ramapo $2.2 million for capital improvements. What happened to that money? No mention of that. So now you have $3.2 million. That could have went to fix a roof. What happened to it? Your guess is as good as mine.
And, you know, when all of that was going on back in September, October, they could have actually done something to replace a roof, or started at least. But, Tony, I'm not an engineer. I don't think you can put a new roof on when it's negative degrees out there. I don't think that it works at this point in time in the winter.
No, it doesn't.
You tell me if I'm wrong. I don't know.
No, you're not wrong at all. But here's the thing with Carlucci's money, that the $1 million that people fail to realize. East Ramapo has to upfront that money,
right,
and do the repairs, and then request reimbursement from the state,
right,
and they'll get the money back.
Right.
Where's the money?
I don't know.
Yeah. How long?
Where's the beef? We never know, because everything is done so secretively in East Ramapo.
Well, thank you for calling, Peter.
Thank
we have
you.
Another call.
Thank you, Peter.
So, good morning to the East Ramapo Underground on WRCR 1700.
I got a question. Does East Ramapo stay underneath the tax so they get the start program, since they have all these problems and need this money?
I don't understand your question.
He wants to know if our budget stayed under the tax cap.
Oh, absolutely. We had a
We
had a self-imposed tax cap before the governor instituted his tax cap. As a matter of fact, Aaron Weider was the one that raised taxes one year when expenses were going up 5%. 0.25% he raised taxes.
And by the way, we should mention that at the time, Steve Price was a trustee on the school board, and he warned against spending the reserves, because Steve Price said the tax cap is coming next year. What's your plan? But they did not heed his advice, and so we have the mess that we have today.
So what you're saying is everybody's going to get the SPA program.
Yes, I believe that's true. For the East Ramapo portion of their taxes, yes.
Well, you know, apparently the voters don't vote. You know, I mean, the Hasidic community votes as a block, and I give credit for that, because nobody else does it. But you know what? If the other people don't want to participate, don't want to vote, you know, one way of prodding them is, hey, look, you know what? They need the money, raise the taxes, and they don't get a start program. And you watch how the people will start coming out to the polls.
Well, you know, the people have been coming out to the polls.
Well, the start program you would still get. It's the tax rebate check that you wouldn't get. The two different animals.
Right.
Oh, they are.
Yeah. You would get the star rebate even if you went over the tax cap.
Okay, right. So someplace along the line, somebody's not getting something in their pocket. And when that happens, usually people start yelling.
Well, I don't think that the board is going to put forth a budget that exceeds the tax cap, because that doesn't sell well with their community.
Well, the tax cap this year is 0.12%.
Oh my gosh!
Thank you, Governor Cuomo.
Wow! Wow! That's astounding.
They did talk about the budget at the last meeting, and mm-hmm. because of the unbridled growth in East Ramapo, in the town of Ramapo,
mm-hmm.
They can actually raise $1 million. Even at that 0.12%, they can get an additional $1 million in taxes.
That's all, though?
That's all. Oh, yeah.
Wow, that's breathtaking.
And the budget was called, you know, the last couple of years, ever since Dr. Ostacha left, they've been doing a game called Let's Have a Pie in the Sky Budget Presentation. So that's right. What they did this time around. But this time, Dr. Wortham called it an aspirational budget, or commonly known as BS.
Well, what they're asking for is for everyone to say, to give them a list of everything they want, you know, as though there were no restrictions on the budget at all. You want to return BOCES school training for trades for the high school students? Put that in there. You want to return collaborative classrooms for special ed? Put that in there. You want to return art and music that is mandated by the state? Put that in there, even though they have no money to support any of those additions.
Hey, Peggy, full-day kindergarten in East Ramapo.
There you go.
That's what Dr. Wortham said.
How great would that be? So they're talking about all these programs. I don't know, Tony. Maybe if the board would put their own agenda aside and do what's best for the kids, they would accept the $15 million being offered by NYSED, and those programs could actually be restored. But their pride will not let them do what is right for the public school students and take the money with the oversight and veto power that is being suggested. So there is a way, there is a path to restoring all of those programs, but they certainly are fighting it tooth and nail and not what's doing best for the kids.
Yes, Peggy, and it's quite ironic. You know, it's Lincoln's birthday today, Black History Month, and we have, you know, children suffering in the East Ramapo civil rights violations. Their rights are being trampled on by a school board who claims that they're the victim in all of this. How ironic is that?
Very. But we've seen it before. Nothing new.
So you know, the gym, going back to the gym, you know, the caller on the morning show, why would you buy brand new chairs for the public to sit on when you have chairs for the public to sit on?
Right. You know, and the thing is there are times when there are really high issues of high importance in the community. And, you know, you will see maybe 400 or 500 people showing up for those meetings. But in general, and as you saw last week when you entered into this gigantic gymnasium, now turned into a quasi-boardroom, there were only maybe, 20 people in the audience?
Two dozen. I counted them.
Two dozen. And so 24 people would fit very comfortably in the old boardroom. And that's the way that's the attendance of most of the school board meetings. So this was overkill by a landslide. I mean, there was just no need. There are chairs in that building. They've been used many, many times. We have video footage of, you know, people, so many people there that there was overflow into the hallways and even outside. But that is not the usual meeting attendance. So this was frivolous spending, in my opinion, especially when you have books that have been just torn up, and there's pictures that Tony has sent out of these books, and there's only, 24 books for the entire grade?
Yeah.
That those books are being used? Entire grade in that particular building.
And one more thing about the chairs. I like to thank all the teachers who sent me pictures of the schools and the conditions of the textbooks. Mm-hmm. They've also sent me, since they were out outlandish spending on the brand new chairs. They sent me pictures of chairs that students have to sit in today, broken down chairs. And they'll be up, and I'll be sending them out this week.
Wow.
So we do have a new call. So good morning to the East Ramapo Underground and WRCR 1700.
Hi, good morning. Good morning. Good morning.
Hi,
good morning.
Gracie.
Oh, thank you. I've been involved in PTA since 1980, and it's 5 years that I gave up being the Leland Rickemeyer scholarship person. Even when I didn't have kids in the school, I took care of that. So I do care about East Ramapo. Now, look, maybe I'm provocative, but I have a few things to say. Number one, fine, they got the chairs. We have to go to the board meeting and make sure those chairs stay there. All right? That's number one.
Well, where'd the old chairs go?
That's right. All right?
Mm-hmm.
That's a beautiful question. Thank you for piggybacking on my comments. Very good. Mm-hmm. All right? That's the first thing. From whom do they buy the chairs? Do they get a good price? Is it somebody's aunt's, uncle, sister's, brother's, nephew? Number two. Number three, my husband called this morning something about, second language, and some person said to Steve, but no quinones to get on the phone. It's wonderful to have two languages. Sure, I have two languages, Italian, but I talk it like an American, okay? if you're born in this country, you should speak the native language. I don't care what anybody says, and I'm not backing down with that one. And then to piggyback on people that don't have any cognonis, I got three phone calls this morning from former educators in East Rabbit. I can't call. They recognize my voice. That's why we have this problem. People are afraid. I can't take it.
They are.
Well, Gracie, let me tell you, for those people who are afraid out there, they can always email me at eastrampounderground@hotmail.com, and I'll put their letters on the air,
without giving their name. Because somebody commented on what my Ron said this morning, that the kids are really not learning English in the Spanish class, in the Jewish class, whatever class, okay? And my husband was an educator in New York City for 33 years, so he knows what he's talking about. Well, listen, have a good day.
You too, Gracie.
Bye, sweetie.
Bye-bye.
Sweeties.
Well, wait. She called me a sweetie, isn't that
weird? Well, you are. Well, when you're not being a tough guy, you are.
Well, yeah, I won't talk about my tough guy image.
Okay, Lieutenant.
Because, I'm really a sweetie at heart.
I know that.
But
can we talk about I did call in to respond to Mr. Gestetner when he called in this morning. But for those of you who were not listening at that point, he was saying that there was a big deal made about the Yiddish Yiddish-speaking classes, and I refute that 100%. There was not a big deal made over that. We welcome the Yiddish-speaking students into East Ramapo. I've been told by many, many people that most of the yeshivas speak only Yiddish or Hebrew for the first 3 years that the students are attending school. And as long as they're teaching English, which is mandated, I don't have a problem with that. But what I do have a problem with is that then they get ELL services and title funds from kindergarten to 12th grade in many cases. When in the public school community, the Spanish-speaking students, the Creole-speaking students, are expected to gain mastery within 3 years. There were a lot of problems surrounding the Yiddish special education program that was implemented at Elmwood Elementary School. And some of the problems included that the students were they were K through 2 grade students in a school that was for grades 3 through 6. They had their own separate entrance. They did not mix with the rest of the students. It was not the least restrictive environment because they were not with children who were their own age. There was problems because of new equipment that was purchased is exclusively used by the segregated Yiddish classrooms. And they were made aware of all of these issues before they implemented that classroom, because I was in the meeting to discuss bringing this classroom to Elmwood.
Oh, you mean...
The,
Peggy, the meeting that Nathan Rothschild fell asleep?
No, this is the meeting that Daniel Schwartz, then president of the school board, told the special education people that I could not be included in the meeting, that I was not allowed to be present at the meeting. It was a planning meeting to bring the special education Yiddish-speaking students into the public schools. So they would be in, they would be within the law that NYSED was citing them for not fulfilling. So Schwartz said I couldn't come, but you know me, I don't always listen to what I'm told, and I showed up anyway. And Ellie Wiseman was nice enough not to call security, and the rest of the Orthodox parents that were around that table were shocked and horrified that I was told that I couldn't attend. So that's the meeting that and they were very embracing to me and very kind to me, and we had a very good dialogue. But we told them, and Kim Foskey was in that meeting as well, and we told them that, you know, to put those children in that particular school where they were not with kids their own age was not least restrictive. We explained our concerns about buying all new equipment for those kids while the kids in the Spanish-speaking special ed classes were getting no new equipment. So all of those things were borne out by the, there was a complaint filed by the NAACP and a parent. And the OCR, which is Office of Civil Rights, found the claims to be true. And so they worked out an agreement with the school district to try to remediate those problems. So there's the answer to that. And, you know, Mr. Gestetner tries to, you know, just... They talk about they don't want their entire community to be broad-brushed, which I try very hard not to do. If I have a problem with somebody, I'm going to call you by name. And I disagree with what Steve said earlier, too, because he said that he thought it was going to go to the point of being libelous. I'm not here to libel anybody. If I'm calling, I've got a quote in front of me that I'm reading from, or I'm talking from hearing somebody else's comments on the radio. And I'm not here to libel people. I'm here to tell the truth. So there's that, you know. People. And in the meantime, Weider is allowed to call in and attack Ed Day, county executive, with unfounded remarks, and he's allowed to continue on. And so I just have to put my 2 cents in there.
And boy, did you put your two... I think you put the whole roll of pennies in there.
I think I did. I'm sorry.
it's quite all right. You're forgiven.
Thank you.
You know, but the kids in Ramapo High School, they're still wondering...
The raindrops are falling on my head and they keep falling.
They keep falling and it's only going to get worse. And the problem with the mole.
Oh, yes, the mole.
How could there be no mole when you have leaks in a building for years?
10 years in some cases, yes. Yeah.
Oh, and we do have another caller. So good morning to the East Ramapo Underground on WRCR 1700.
Good morning, Tony. Good morning, Peggy.
Good morning, Amelia.
How are you?
Good.
Cold, Amelia.
Yes. Hi. Peggy, you in Florida in warm weather and we're freezing over here?
Yeah, I am. I'm sorry to say. Although we did have ice on the windows and the cars earlier this week, so it does get below freezing here.
Okay, so then I don't feel that bad.
No.
I'm calling because I've heard a few people have called me to say that there was no mold in this high school, and I know, you know, there were mold. I don't know exactly what the report said, but I know that one of the sheets were missing.
Right.
So if a sheet is omitted,
right.
Something is omitted in a report, then you really don't have a complete report.
Right.
But it really doesn't matter whether the mold was, you know, white mold, blue mold, red mold. It's mold. And in any other school, that part of the building or the whole building would have been closed until it's taken care of. In East Ramapo, the students have spent a lot of years with mold and holes in the ceilings and messed up floors. You know, it's just that our children are being neglected, and the people know it. The board members know it. Former board members know it. Aaron Weider knows. And you know, the way to turn people's eyes away from the real problem is to come up with things like it's the formula, or it's the school, it's the federal government's job because they don't give us enough money. And you know, the problem is priority should be on educating the children. And you know, Weider is around. He's a nice guy when you see him in public, but when you see him, you're standing alone with him, you're talking, he's trying to talk to you or instigate you. He's not a nice guy, and we all know that. Mm-hmm. I was watching a program on TV, the board meeting they had, two board members asked questions about a contract, because they apparently the norm was to just, you know, vote on contracts without having the contract. Two new board members asked, I would like to see the contract, because you know, I don't know what the contract says. I feel, you know, I don't feel comfortable voting without seeing the contract. Mm-hmm. Well, Aaron Weider had a temper tantrum, and I'm talking about, he spent a long time talking. It was unbelievable, very disrespectful. And he talked, and then he turned it around. He said, well, how can you tell the people? He named some organizations, and he's a few of them, and said, can you tell these organizations that you want to see the contract? You don't want to vote for them? There are needy people, needy children, needy people who needs this money, and you saying no, can you come? And I wanted to ask him. I was watching the program, so I couldn't really talk to him, but I wanted to ask him, where was he when Colton was closed, when Hillcrest was closed, when he was on the board and we were coming, parents after parents, students after students, teachers, we were crying for help, and he sat there as if we were invisible. And then now he's worried about children, he's worried about the community. I said, right. That was really, really, he should get an award for that performance, but we know it's just a performance, and he needs to learn to respect people, because you want somebody to respect you, you need to respect people. That was uncalled for. His behavior on that board was inappropriate. And I want to tell him that in person. So I want to say thank you and have a wonderful weekend. And keep fighting. You're doing a great job for our children. I'm sure they all appreciate your fight. You guys are just great. Thank you so much.
Well, you've been in the battle with us all these years, Amelia. So we appreciate you as well.
Thank you, Amelia.
Thank you.
Thanks, Amelia.
Our studio lines are open, 845-362-0013. There's 12 minutes to go on the show, so now here's the rush. Call before you cut off.
Very true. What Amelia said is true. You know, we have, Tony, you have years worth of footage, video footage of these board meetings, and you know, we begged for teachers not to be terminated. There were 450 staffers cut during his
reign of terror.
Well, yeah, the architect is how I refer to him, the architect of destruction. And I remember begging him in the hallways before they took the votes to cut those people. And it seemed to me at the time that he wasn't really listening to what I was saying. I was begging for programs, especially, you know, I advocate for the special education children to not be cut, and he didn't even know what the programs were, and yet they were cutting them. There was a time when, I don't know if you were there or not, Tony, at that point, but there was a time where they cut a program called SIFE, S-I-F-E,
And that program was to help students that were coming from countries where they had no formal education. And these were high school students, and what they were trying to do was to at least get them to learn the language and gain some skills that would be marketable in the workplace. And it was a pittance of money, but it helped so many kids that would otherwise just not even bother coming to school. And I begged them to not cut that program. Well, they cut it, and then after they cut it, one of the board members famously said, well, what is that program? After they made the cut.
Yeah, when they adjourned the session and we're going to executive session. I remember
exactly that. And so, you know, they're cutting programs that they don't understand because they're not programs that they have in the yeshivas. You know, of course they don't have people from Africa coming to their schools, or, you know, people from other countries where there's no education coming to their schools. So they didn't understand the value of it. And that therein is a big part of the problem. If you don't understand what you're cutting, should you really be voting on it, or should you ask what the program is before the cut takes place?
And we do have another caller. So good morning to the East Ramapo Underground on WRCR 1700. Good morning.
Good morning, East Ramapo Underground. A lady called before, she was highly agitated, saying that people do not speak the native language. Is that correct or incorrect? There's something.
You're on a cell phone and it's cutting off
right,
a little
right.
bit.
What I'm saying is, there was a lady called before. She said, "You know, these people do not learn the native language of our country."
Right.
But I didn't know we had a native language. Native language might be Apache, Seminole, or Cherokee, or something. You know?
So, actually, there is no Okay, there is no. You have to wait till I have to speak first. It's my show. There is no native language in the United States, official language.
Unfortunately.
But English is encouraged, and in order to get ahead in this country, for the most part, you need to learn basic English.
Well, Tony, don't you need to? You need to be able to pass the English Regents exams, and so that is a requirement that you learn English if you're attending school. Is that not true?
That is true.
So although there's not a native language, as far as education is concerned, you do have to master English in order to graduate high school. And, in fact, to pass from one grade to the next.
That's
how it should be.
Also, the commercial airline pilot, you must know English also. But that's something else.
Yeah, I thought you also need to know Spanish to be a pilot, or at least an international pilot.
I flew on a few international flights too, but I flew in coach.
That's
the pilot. That's the information when the plane ditches in the ocean, how to get out, all right? So you can get out safely from the plane and survive. That's what the Spanish is for, not the pilot.
Okay, thank you for calling. Man.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I had such a hard time hearing
you. He really needs
Tony.
To get a different device. He needs an upgrade in a cell phone. It looks like he's using a flip phone or something, or in a bad area.
I don't know. But, you know, but the point of the matter is that, yes, you do have to master English to graduate from school, and you do have to pass English courses in order to progress from one grade to the next.
And there are funds that are given to the yeshivas and the public schools in order to help you learn English.
Right. Master English, absolutely.
But people don't understand. By master English, they expect you to be weeded out of this program within 3 years.
As I said, our kids in public schools are expected to gain mastery within 3 years. There is no such requirement in the yeshivas, and I have a problem with that.
And we do have a rush of phone calls.
Okay, of course. It's like the last 5 minutes. Go.
Good morning to the East Ramapo Underground at WRCR 1700. Good morning.
Hi. My name's Richard Senna. Hi, Peggy.
Hi,
hey, Richard.
How are you, Richard?
Good. Peggy, I don't even know what to say anymore after the last couple of weeks of the videos and what's occurring. But what we're not talking about is how we got to this point. And you know, it's a point of our politics. It's our public elected officials who are always politicking. They're not governing. You know, after the elections, they should be governing. Where is our five supervisors? Where is the 17 members of the legislature? Where are they? Why aren't they coming out and denouncing this hate? Okay?
Yes, I agree.
Because what's happening here is no different than what happened in Germany.
Yeah.
Okay? People are looking the other way. What's happening here is no different than what happened in the Catholic Church. All good people, but no one's talking about the children. And no one's talking about our political system, even on a federal level,
mm-hmm.
about term limits,
right.
Okay? About having party chairs being commissioners of an election board, okay? We
yep.
know the election fraud that we have had in this county. We've had one of our elected officials put in jail, but of course he was only put in jail for 16 days. If he was
weekend. Wasn't he a weekend program
yeah,
only?
Yeah, 16 days, and they broke it up into 8 days. If
right.
he was a black man, do you think that would have happened? Do you think he would have been put away for years?
Right. It's a federal crime.
There is something wrong here. There is something wrong when a municipality on American soil tells people what to wear, what side of the street to cross on. Where is our elected officials? Where are they? Why aren't they coming out?
Unfortunately, I think you know the answer to that. Many of them are very comfortable where they are, and they don't want to rock the boat and speak out. But on the other hand, I'll say this. There are Republicans who are doing everything they can for the public school kids in East Ramapo. There are Democrats who are doing everything they can for the kids of East Ramapo. And then there's the Ramapo machine, which are exclusively Democrats. And some of them work absolutely against the interests of the public school kids, and they're not taken to task
yep.
because they know their seats are safe.
And we're down to our last 3 minutes.
Okay,
so we'll have to let you go, Richard.
Thank you, Richard.
Thank you, and we have one more call.
Antonio, good morning. How are you doing?
Hi, who is this?
Hi, this is Danny. How are you doing this morning?
Good, Danny. How are you?
Great. I'm hearing all this conversation about the East Ramapo School District and the Ramapo School District. Let's start from the bottom, from the ground up. First of all, I mean, I hear kids in Clarktown, North Clarktown, and other high school that are talking about the East Ramapo. You go to East Ramapo? Oh, my God. You go to Ramapo? I think we should change the name to, like, Walt Whitman School District or something else like that that's commemorable. You know what I'm saying?
Well, you have to realize, Danny, at one time, East Ramapo Central School District was the jewel school district in New York State.
I know it was, but they're asleep at the wheel now, like that gentleman just said. Where is everybody?
Mm-hmm.
You know, where's all the help that we need? These are all of our children, your children, my children. I have five children that graduated from, they went to Little Tour, they went to Pomona Middle School, they went to Ramapo High School, they all graduated with honors, they're all in professional careers, some of them have their own companies. What happened to the school district? And why are we airing our dirty laundry all over the world? I was down in South Carolina 3 weeks ago, and the guy, I was talking about my kids graduating from Ramapo, and he goes, are you kidding me? I said, no. I said, my kid's a professional chef, and 14 is Rye Brook, New York. He works with the Iron Chef that's on television. My daughter, she runs a brunch.
Danny, one second, because we have a short minute of time.
Here's my thing to you. You're saying, why are we airing our dirty laundry? The answer to that question is that if you don't make what is going on public, and in your words, airing dirty laundry, then there can never be a solution. And the kids deserve better. And I have said over and over again, who are the victims? The students are the victims.
And
not the Orthodox community, not the Catholic community, not any other community. It's the public school students of East Ramapo. They're the victims. They're the reason we do this show.
And
because we do want the world to know. We want the word out there.
And
that
Peggy,
it's an unfair system.
And Peggy, people have to know, this is the underlying question.
And I wonder, still I wonder.
And thank you, listeners, for calling up and listening to the show. We'll be back next month. Who
and
wants to be
Valentine's
a volunteer
Day.
Is next.
This is AM 1700 WRCR and WRCR HD Ramapo. The news follows, and then it's Who Wants to Be a Volunteer, all coming up.